But I don't want to shoot another DNews episode. This is the worst. Hey friends, Trace here for DNews. Thanks for watching. Unsurprisingly, emotions are difficult to pin down. Even the definition is a little nebulous. A natural instinctive state of mind deriving from one's circumstances, mood, or relationship with others. Think about that. Circumstances, or mood, or relationships. That's pretty much everything we ever do. Emotions are a visceral state of mind. They hit hard and fast, and they're something that philosophers and scientists have struggled with explaining for millennia. Emotions start in the brain. So if we wanted emotional maturity, we'd probably have to talk about brain maturity first, right? According to neuroscience, the brain reaches full maturity around 25, though it varies from person to person. The last to mature is the prefrontal cortex, the area associated with executive functions, i.e. risk assessment, forward thinking, goal setting, evaluation, and emotional regulation. Ideally, by 25, we understand our place in ourselves, which explains why teenage emotions seem to run so much hotter than adults. Emotional development comes in two groups, basic emotion and higher emotion. The basics are inborn, they're universal, and they were defined by anthropologist Paul Ekman in the 1970s, and they are joy, sadness, anger, fear, surprise, and disgust. Babies, adults, everyone experiences these emotions. If I do this, you know I'm disgusted, right? It's the same thing for everybody. Higher emotions like jealousy, envy, guilt, shame, pride, and embarrassment come later, once the brain learns self-awareness and self-consciousness. But the problem is, emotions aren't easy to quantify. Just because we don't understand them doesn't mean we don't experience them though, right? And that was shown in a hilariously cute study done by Brigham Young this month. They looked at children 6 and under competing in a block building contest. The winners and losers were rigged so they could study their emotional responses. The losers just shrugged it off and they usually moved on right away. But winners stood, hands on their hips, chest out, and had obvious swagger. I know what that's like. The brain of a 2-year-old is not self-aware or self-conscious, really, so they shouldn't understand pride, but there they were, swagging it up. And when they were asked about their feelings later, younger kids who were shown pictures of people expressing pride would identify it in others if they were 4 or older, but not in themselves. 5-year-olds could see it in themselves and others, indicating that we're developing our emotions and our understanding of them as we age. So if someone slaps you in the face violently and unexpectedly, you're gonna turn red, you're gonna feel angry, and you're gonna have an indescribable urge to lash out. If you're younger, that emotion can override your rational decision-making and cause you to do something you might later regret, right? But that's not always the case. Studies from the University of California, Santa Barbara found inducing anger in participants helped them be more analytical, not more irrational. Their findings unexpectedly found that even usually irrational thinkers became careful thinkers when they were angry, suggesting that anger isn't only a physical fight or flight response, but can also focus the mind and help with decision making. This is the problem that we come to when we're studying our emotions. They're so fleeting and deep-seated that they are difficult to measure sometimes. But according to an essay from the University of California, Berkeley, emotions help organize our thoughts. They keep our perceptions on track and motivate our social interactions. So the more emotional maturity we have, the better we can learn from our emotional responses. A scientist from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine describes disgust as affecting who we're gonna kiss, who we're gonna mate with, who we're gonna sit next to, and who we're gonna shun. But disgust is one of the least understood emotions because it's not as flashy as the other basics, sadness, anger, or fear. Which brings us to another problem with understanding emotions. There are definitely not just 6. Since the definition of the basic emotion, scientists have argued that there are way more or way less, and some object to categorizing emotion altogether. It's completely personal. There are a lot of strong feelings on the study of emotion, unsurprisingly. Sociologists, psychologists, neurologists, biologists have all got a great need to understand these physiopsychological reactions that hold sway over our everyday lives, but sadly, we kinda suck at it. It's a massive blind spot in science. I mean, we can watch blood flow through your brain with an fMRI. We can scan brain waves with EEGs. We can measure hormones, blood pressure, skin response, facial expressions, and many other physical reactions to the emotion. But we can't objectively measure the emotion itself. Evolutionary psychologists theorize that emotions, particularly the outward expressions of them, were a way for ancient man to signal our social group when we were feeling something inside. Disgust, joy, and anger all have these universal nonverbal cues which tell other social members in our group what is up with us. which may have explained why they've evolved in the first place. Emotions can save lives and facilitate social bonding, but even still, there's a lot more work to do. And we didn't even touch love. Oh, that is way too much for just one DNews. Do you want to know more about emotions or about anything science? Go ahead and ask some questions down in the comments, and maybe we'll make another emotional DNews. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe.